is a beautiful little village. The name of the comes Inistioge, it means the Inch of Teague. Inch is a long narrow strip of land between the river and the sloping woodlands. And Teague, I believe, was the abbot in the old priory there. So yes. that's what the name came from, the Inch of Teague, in Inistioge. Whenever the abbey was founded, do you know anything about that?
Bill? Around the ninth century, they built it.
Yeah. They themselves built it.
Augustinians.
Yeah, were they tradesmen?
Oh yeah, well, definitely every one of them. Yeah.
Were they good tradesmen?
Well, sure, the proof is there, isn't it?
That's correct. What? That's correct. Yes.
We're talking about a ruin today, but some of it is fantastic, sure. But in the meantime, anyhow. What happened to the monastery then was they fished and the river was coming down by the Thomas Stone Road in those days.
Yes.
And they used to fish from it. And they also owned the fishery down the river.
I see.
And at one time.
Yeah, they.
And the
surrounding land.
The students. And the land. The students then used to fish for pleasure and all that.
So they were teachers also?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, the best of scholars, but the students went on strike one time because they were getting too many salmon. It was a little bit of a bore, like it was, and they must have been pretty wealthy, whoever they were.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
why did they go on strike?
They were fed up eating salmon, which is a terrible thing to say, you know.
Yes.
But they had their own land and stuff and all, and eventually a crony comes along, and things went well.
Yeah.
Until then.
Yeah, well, you said there were physicians as well.
Yeah, they were. And great scholars, and they used to do stone. There were stone masons.
Yeah.
There were all type of a workmen there.
Yeah, well, did any of their cures live on to the present day?
Well,
did they keep them all secret?
They did. They kept most of them. I wouldn't know any now, but I know that's. I often heard people talking. The monks had the secrets of several things, cures for different ailments. You know.
Yeah.
But Crummel had done the job on the place and finished it off, blew the top off of the Black Castle.
Yes.
Well, he missed one little church.
Yes.
Going out to New Ross Road.
Old Clodagh.
As I walked down this pathway to the church, the first thing I always noticed is the peace and tranquility of the place. Continuing along this winding walkway, I noticed the giant evergreens that have hidden this little church from the public eye for many generations. Visiting here is almost like going back in time. Due to the low-lying location of the church, it is cut off from the rat race of the busy road which surrounds it. One of the many unique features of this church is its belfry. I recall, as I served as an altar boy in this church, ringing the bell on Sunday mornings at 5 to 9. As the local men gathered around to discuss the topics of the week, such as the crops. Is the hay going to be saved? Is the corn going to be good? Or is the fishing season going to be successful? By this time, the women would have taken their places inside the church. Today, I am entering the church through what is locally known as the women's side. As I approach the door, I can hear the rippling waters of Clodagh Stream. To this day, the stream supplies the parish with its water. I'm standing here on Ballygubb Gallery, one of the three galleries which make up another unique feature of the church. The others being Coolamuck Gallery and Cochrane's Gallery, two of which can be reached from ground level outside. The church itself goes back to the 16th century, having been dug from a deep hollow from amongst the forest trees which surround it. At this time, the structure consisted of a thatched roof and clay floor. In the 1800s, the church was re-roofed and raised his head above the level of the rock for the first time after being completely hidden since the penal times. Another feature of Closey Church is the dugout, which is situated opposite All Saints Gate. This dugout was created in penal times as a hiding place for priests when the Catholic religion was being wiped out by the reigning British forces in Ireland at the time. This place of refuge may have been responsible for the saving of many priests' lives. Leaving this little gem, I realise this church is one of the most beautiful, if not the most beautiful and most historic of all little churches in Ireland.
The only remaining link made with the present, the old monastery, is the St. Mary's Church. Built in 1836, built from the stones they quarried out of the old friary.
Oh, I see. And who is the rector there at the present day?
The present man is Reverend Sands.
Interesting thing, Bill, about St. Mary's Church is its closeness in location to the Catholic Church.
Yes, that's a very rare feature, Ned.
It is, and I heard it said one time that if there was a service going on at the same time in both churches, that each community could hear one another praying.
Sure, yeah, why not?
Would you believe that?
I would, yeah.
Parish priest of Inistioge since 1979. Having succeeded Canon Lockery, who died in August 1979, I came here in November of that year. It was the year that the Pope visited Ireland. Inistioge is a rural parish consisting of three districts, Inistioge, the Clodagh and the Roar. There are about 1,800 people in the whole parish, 900 of them in Inistioge and 900 in the Roar. I am mainly responsible for the spiritual welfare of the people in the district of Inistioge and Clodagh. I look after their spiritual needs, saying Mass for them, administering the sacraments to them, counselling them when they have problems and sharing their joys and sorrows. Inistioge Church was built in 1836 in its present form, and 12 years after the Church of Ireland Church, which was built in 1824. Since that time then it has served as the great centre of Catholic religion in the area. At the back of the church and at the back of the Church of Ireland Church, we have the old cemetery, which was in very poor condition when I came here, but through the help of many of the parishioners, we restored it to some kind of acceptable condition.
Well, going back to the Catholic Church, Bill, St. Columb Kill is the patron saint of the Catholic Church. Exactly. And he has a well dedicated to him up there at the very top of the Coulm.
Yeah.
Do you know much about that well?
Oh, yes. Oh, very much so. Nobody knows it better, actually. And I drew about 6,000 buckets of water out of it.
Did you?
And, yeah, my pals and myself in our days. And coming up and down was a penance. Because you get up with your empty can, you come down with a full one and fall and up again.
Oh.
You couldn't go home then and say, your mother or father would say, go back again. That was it. But another thing, there's an annual mass up there on the 9th of June.
Yes.
Up to the present day. That was the Saints' Day, you know.
Yes, yes. It was a very holy spot up there.
Yeah.
And I believe in medieval...
Well, this is obviously a very old photograph of Inistioge Brass Band, Billy. When was the band actually founded?
It was founded in 1889.
Yeah.
By Dick Follison, a man named Dick Follison. He was the leader of the previous band of fife and drum.
Oh, there was a fife and drum band in the village previously?
Yeah.
But of course the fife is a different instrument from a brass instrument.
It's a woodwind instrument.
Yes.
And they used to play by ear.
Oh, they didn't have any music.
Oh, no.
So, when the brass band started in, they had to learn how to read music.
They had to learn them.
Yeah. And who learned them to?
A man by the old Gorman from Thomastown, a member of the Thomastown Brass Band. And Liam McGrath, and then another man by the name of Deegan, who was an insurance collector, used to stay overnight to learn them.
Yeah. And where did they get the money to buy the instruments?
House-to-house collections and concerts, and Dr. Johnson, who lived above me, and Mrs. Roberts presented an instrument. Lady Louisa Tye presented two instruments. Butlers of the hotel, Woodstock Arms, presented instruments. And Richard Cody, the hotel, presented instruments. And Welsh Brothers presented instruments.
Yeah.
And Newport of Ballygallen, Major New agent for Greens, presented instruments.
Yes, I'm sure they had the whole set of instruments.
Well, after the point, they got them all together.
Yeah. And where did the band practice?
The band practiced in only the High Street, because a lot of the members lived in High Street at that time. There were Tierneys and Whites and Gores and Welshes and Cordies.
Yeah, and of course the bandmaster, Dick Forrest.
Dick Forrest lived in High Street.
Yeah, he lived opposite where Mrs. Roberts is.
That's correct.
That was originally from the Johnson's house.
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah. And
dates back to the 9th century, during Viking activities in Ireland. The original building was extended twice around the time of Brian Boru's reign and again in the latter half of the 12th century when neighbouring Jerpoint Abbey was being founded. The oldest part of Clonamry Church is the west side, where the beautiful doorway with inclining jambs stand. This doorway is also noted for the flat lintel over the doorway with the Maltese cross. Further extensions took place in the 15th and 16th century when the bellcot on the west gable was added. Old names like Brown, Kavanagh, Hutchison, Flood, Barron, Brennan and Milet. Clun was not as lucky as Clodagh at the time of the Cromwellian invasion in the mid-17th century, when on that fateful day, at a spot which is locally known as the Monument, Cromwellian forces toppled the church and rendered it unusable as a parish church ever since. It's back to the 16th century. Around this time, a widow from neighbouring Brownsford had a disobedient son. The widow in turn sought help from Lord Edward Fitzgerald, current owner of the castle and its surrounding lands at the time. She asked of Lord Fitzgerald to discipline her unruly son. Fitzgerald promised her that she would have no more trouble from him and to leave him at the castle for a few days in order to have him disciplined. On her return, to her great sorrow, she found her son hanging from the shafts of a horse's cart in the courtyard of the castle. On seeing this, she took revenge on Fitzgerald by cursing the castle and all that lived within its walls. She swore that the four winds of heaven would blow in and out through its gables, and that the birds of the air would nest in its walls, and that no man would be left to protect it. Although this is just local legend, many claim it is true. And so, in the summer of 1691, Lord Edward Fitzgerald rode out from Clun Castle to fight for king and country at Ockram, leaving behind his wife, Lady Eleanor. On the 12th day of July 1691, Fitzgerald was slain on the battlefield of Ockram, and so ended the Fitzgerald reign of Clun Castle. To this day, the castle stands in ruin, and along with it, the mystery of the widow's curse.
Even birds are hushed and quiet, lark and robin, all are still, as the silent band of people move across the sleeping hill. Steady streams of silent people, tearful women, watchful men, come from hill and field and valley to the mass rock in the glen. And when all have come together, priest and people softly pray, high above them in the heather, fast asleep the watchman lay. In his dream a drum is beating, drum beats wake him from his dream, red coats streaming down the mountain, red coats crossing bog and streams. Then on feet that knew the mountains, heartbeat beating to the drum, he ran swiftly to the mass rock. Father, fly, the redcoats come. Now on every side a soldier, muskets ready in their hands. In a flash the priest is hidden, but dressed in gold the watchman stands. Do no harm to simple people, let the innocent go free. If the priest you wish to capture, take me then, for I am he. There they hanged him by the mass rock, twined their troops, and marched away. And the man who slept in heather woke with God that very day.
So in 1540, following the dissolution of the monasteries, the property was granted to Edmund Butler, the 9th Earl of Ormond. Then in the late 1600s, his successor, James Butler, who was the 13th Earl of Ormond, sold the property to Captain Stephen Sweet, who was an officer in King William's army. Then in 1709, Captain Sweet's granddaughter, Elizabeth, married Kenrick Founds. They had a son, whom they also called William. The young William married a lady called Sarah Ponsonby, and they also had a daughter called Sarah. Then in 1744, William decided to build the mansion now known as Woodstock. He used the architect Francis Bindon to design the house. Francis Bindon based his design on a Tudor royal palace in Oxfordshire. Then in 1765, Sarah married a landowner from County Wicklow, William Toy. They had a son, whom they also called William. They had two sons, Frederick and Brian. Frederick, as a little fella, loved to ride on a donkey, and he would come down the main avenue there, right down to the main entrance gates. And one day, whatever happened, the little fella got a fall off the donkey and received an injury. And the story I heard was that his mother's religion was Christian Scientist, and she didn't believe in getting medical attention. She believed that the little fellow would eventually get better. Well, that never happened. The little fellow died. And that's his grave that you see down there in the Thai burial plot, with the little white marble stone, little white marble angel over his grave. That was in 1911. So this then left but one son, Brian Thai. Then in 1917, the father, Edward Thai, went over to London, and he was attacked in his bedroom by a burglar. And the burglar grabbed up the poker and struck Edward Thai on the head, killing him. So his wife then, the Smith lady, was left on her own with the children in Woodstock. And it was a time of trouble and uprising in the country, so she didn't like to be there, I suppose, on her own. So she decided to close up the house, and she went back to England, bringing the children with her.
Well, what other buildings do they have around on the estate, Bill?
Well, it's your the famous Red House, number one.
What do they use that for?
The all parties and dances and all the music sessions.
Yeah. Luxurious.
Down at the time.
Luxurious living.
The house of luxury. That's what it was.
Yeah. Well, then near there is the Swiss cottage.
Right.
What was that?
Another, the opposite.
Yes.
To relax.
Oh.
And paint and read poetry and all this, you know.
Oh, I see.
That was the Swiss cottage is about.
Yes.
A lovely, beautiful place.
And there's a waterfall, I think.
A beautiful waterfall, yeah.
What height's built with that water?
It was, of course, about 80 feet and it would drop.
Is it?
They often heard it, yeah.
Yeah.
And then there was Teddington.
Yeah,
down there.
What went on there?
Ah, sure, that was the forester's house.
Oh, I see.
The forester used to be. So then they had, it was a party, they used to party there too, you know.
Yes.
And Mum Sanford.
Yeah.
The ladies used to rest there when they come to that point.
I see.
When they go down to the village.
Yes.
And then you had...
Well, was that used that as was, a lookout post?
No, Sanford was a lookout post, yeah.
I see.
In previous times, when the boats would be coming up the river, they should pay a toll there.
Oh.
You know. And if they didn't do that, they'd fire some kind of a cannonball or something they had.
Oh.
They know stuff. There was another house, of course, near the Cannon House.
Yes.
Down further down the river. They used to pay tolls there too in ancient days.
I see.
And then you had the Hunt and the Snell's.
Yeah.
Or the Garner's House.
Oh, the Garner's House, yeah. That was that's a lovely cut stone.
A lovely house, yeah. Well,
so these people, lived in a luxurious lifestyle.
Yeah, paradise.
Yeah.
Paradise.
And that would be quite different from the lifestyle of the people here in the village.
The people in the village, they got it. Some of them had it good, more of them hadn't, you know.
What do you think of the state of Woodstock House now and the gardens, Bill, as compared to what they were years ago?
I'll tell you the truth, very sad to see the state of it at the moment.
It is.
Present day, compared to long ago, you know.
Yes.
Very sad.
Yeah.
It was, when Woodstock was Woodstock, this Mr. Toy was taking a party around the gardens above one day. They had a big shoot outside and they were having a big meal inside in the house at night, but he was showing them the gardens. And they were commenting on the beauty of the place.
Yes.
And Ty turned around and he said, pointed up at the house, "Ladies and gentlemen," he said, "you see that beautiful building there? That," he says, "will be a rookery for the crows. This place will go as a cairn," he said. "Woodstock. Yes. The building," he said, "will be a rookery for the crows, and the patch you're walking on at the moment be cowpats."
Or I was. And he said he was too tired to go any farther, he refused to go. So my father was feeding cattle there even, so he had to put him up. And the next morning, that, they got word that the tens were supposed to be tipped off, like, you know. A woman that was passing and see the O'Malley in Holland was on the road and having a chat.
Yeah.
And the tens came over the road and went over to Jim McDonald's, now Kappa, and searched it. And O'Malley was looking over the road after him and said, he described him as a nice bag.
Right.
Yeah. And they went in for their breakfast then, and when they were in the breakfast, the tens came in behind them into their parlour in the room. And O'Malley jumped up with to pull a revolver out of his pocket and got caught in the line. And as well as that, O'Malley had a diary in the room left open with all the names of all the volunteers.
So what happened to your place?
The result is that they were all arrested and brought out and tied to the apple trees while they tried to burn the place. And they tried to burn my grandmother then at the time, and she was an invalid in the bed.
And what happened, why didn't they?
Well, the priest was calling and coming out on a sick call, and that shed in the haggard at the time burning, and he told him, "Do your best, your damn best," as he described it. And you won't burn it.
And how long did it take?
They gave 3 days to train it.
Never burned it?
No, never burned it.
Right, and what were the prisons like up in Woodstock?
They were, they were kept in down in the dungeons under in Woodstock, and never taken out of handcuffs. My Uncle Jack was, his job was to take up the boys, and when they wanted to go to the toilet, and take down the trousers and so forth, and in handcuffs all the time.
Right.
With the results that they were cut to the bone. I believe my Uncle Tom didn't pass. You see it, did you?
I saw the hands of Fox.
Yeah.
When he was let out, so big. His hands were swollen. God, and how long were they in Woodstock?
3 or 4 days, I think.
Oh, he was varnished, didn't he?
Varnished, yeah.
I caught my first fish at 2.5 years of age with my late grandfather, Jim Crow, on this very river, only 100 yards from here at a location commonly known as the Bucket. Both my grandfathers fished, my father. I suppose most of my relations are traditional snap-net fishermen. Tradition has it that most fishermen cannot swim. The reason is that it gives them more respect for the water. I remember one hot summer, I was fishing with my late father, and I spotted a seal swimming upstream. We had just killed a fish, and because he had smelt the kill, he was eagerly making his way towards our cots, although we made sure he didn't steal our catch. And for the duration of the night's fishing, the seal followed all the crews who were catching fish, but with no luck. But getting back to snap-net fishing, which is a dwindling tradition in these areas, let me introduce you to the technique involved before it disappears completely.
Good.
The boat used in this type of fishing is known as a cot. Usually two fishermen make up the crew, each in a cot. The net itself is known as a snap-net. It is made up of two sets of ropes at either end, known as the top and rope, with a lead weight on the lower rope. This weight is used for detecting the riverbed. The net is spread between the two cots and is pulled in an open position with the flow of tide. If a fish enters the net, The bottom rope is pulled sharply. This closes the net, and then both ropes are quickly pulled in together until the catch surfaces. One member of the crew gets to the fish and instantly kills it with a small piece of wood, locally known as a smartine.
PJ.
In the good old days, up to 40 fish could be caught in one night's fishing. However, fish numbers have been falling through the years, and unfortunately with it, the number of crews. The majority of caught stocks along the river banks are now deserted. Even though interest is still apparent among the youth, I feel in another 15 years, there may be no longer any crews left on these waters. In the trees and greenery of Coolamook Wood lies one of the Nore's hidden features. At the end of Clody Stream lies a two-tier waterfall by the name of Kerryhole. Story has it that the pond which lie at the bottom of this glorious fall is bottomless. A local man by the name of Alan owned a mill in the place called the Hollow in Coolamook. He set out to find the depth of the pond by using a rope and a millstone which had his initials on it. He proceeded to lower the millstone into the pond. However, the stone never reached the bottom despite the vast length on the rope, and therefore he began to withdraw the stone back from the pond. However, the millstone became detached and fell back down into the water.
Cool.
It is said many years later, Mr. Allen had emigrated to Australia, having given up his milling career, was strolling along a beach one day, when to his surprise, he noticed a millstone in the sand. On turning it over, he discovered his initials on the stone and realized it was the very stone he had lost years previous in Kerryhole.
Walking down Grafton Street, I used to Phillips Grampton. But I was walking down early and I started facing them. One of the nuns put her head up to heaven and she said, "And God forgive me," she says, "but I don't know what to do." The other one turned around because she said, "My lad even knows what to do anyway," she says.
While in Stage, as the sun was setting, all the breeze, green meadows, so fresh and fair, to all the plains, set the hands of blazing, and brought the neighbours from far and near, for 2 days constant, to view those monsters, the people came, in the constant stream, but no one seemed to mind those flyers, till the two with paddles came on the scene. They advanced to meet them, shook hands to greet them, no introduction did they require. In Cabner's Corn they slept till morning, he's hanging on to our little flyer.
There was a circus came to Inistioge one time, and there was a £10 note for anyone who'd ride this bucking bronco. And the several went in and the mule turned him off. Couldn't stay on. But this fella came down and he was half drunk. And he came down, the wife was in the audience. And she said, "Oh God," she said, "look at this idiot, come on. He's going to make a show of me." So we got up anyway, and no way could he be thrown off of the mule. Rode away and got a £10 note. But when he got a £10 note, she was all about him. So after a while anyway, he made his way up the steps, up to where she was sitting in the circus. And she was all about him. She said, "Oh, my God, John," she said, "you're a great man. How did you do it?" "Oh," he said, "no bother." He said, "do not remember the night." He said, "you had the hiccups."
I did a time the truth in 21.
They weren't minding anything and all the gates was open. Traffic and all could pass through it. Yeah. I went there myself and a crowd of young lads was around here that time. And the cross gate there was on to the town and sentry in it. But then we went down below. There were two towns there at that gate. They used to be opening the gates, letting the lorries in and out. And there was a black and tan officer, the name of Captain Moon, living in the lodge. Robbie Bates was living above in the lodge that time. He was married. And it seemed the tan's wife and Bates' wife seemed to be friends. And she ever pushed in to the tan's wife. So Robbie had a queer way of talking. That's what he say after every word. So the tan officer met him on. He said, "Your wife gave my wife, what was it? A pusheen. That's what my wife gave Mrs. Moon. A pusheen."
He came down one evening from work, myself and Ned Brennan. I went into Phelan's pub for a drink. There was a Yank in it. She was very interested to find out about Inistioge and the graveyard. She thought she had some distant relations buried there. So she was talking to us anyway, and we got a couple of bottles, and she asked us, nobody sure the graveyard, so we did. And went back up to Phelan's pub, and she walked in and she got a glass of gin for herself and left us the way we were. And then she turned around and she said she'd give £1,000 to kiss the lips, to kiss the Blarney Stone. And after a while she got another glass of gin and tonic, and she said she'd give £1,000 to kiss the lips, to kiss the Blarney Stone. So he turned around and he said, "I didn't kiss it," he said, "I sat on it, that's any good here."
Five or 6 years, eh?
Go on, more.
Well, seven anyway.
So I was born, isn't it?
No, but how long are you the mayor of Inistioge?
I'm 6 years.
Six years.
I have no real right account, but I'm sure that it's 6 years.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah. You were in the army too, was it? When did you go to the army? 1939, wasn't it?
1939.
And you done the 5 years, you done the 39 or 45.
Done the full term, in it.
A lot of moving around, you were stationed in different places.
All over the country.
Well, on James you were in, weren't
you? On James, Flood Hall.
You were in Clonmel too, weren't you?
Clonmel, Mortford.
The Corra, were you ever in the Corra?
I was,
Queer days. There were queer days in it.
There were some queer days,
Some good days and some bad days.
Some good ones.
Pay was fairly small that time.
Pay was small, 13.
13 and something a week,
Tuppence a week.
Paid every Wednesday.
Paid every Wednesday.
You wouldn't have much left Friday, like.
Oh, you wouldn't have much left Thursday more.
I suppose not, no.
No.
When you put the shoe in the fire and heat it up and then take it out and it fit it onto the horse's hoof, burn it in as we call it, like, and get it level, and then you're satisfied, you cool off the shoe and you nail it on and we finish it off. And we nail it on first, then finish it off, and that'll be all that's in it.
And how long would it take you?
That's just 5 hours. Take about 5 minutes or 10 minutes to redden the shoe.
And what stage, like, when do you put in the bucket of water?
When you're finished.
Right at the end, yeah.
When you're satisfied that you have it leveled.
Right.
On the hoof, like.
What does leveling mean?
Yeah, but have it leveled when you're going to lay it on level.
Is that what the burning in
is? Yeah, yeah.
Burn away all the extra.
Yeah. You would leave it down on the hoof.
Right.
Leave it down like that. And the hoof wouldn't be level. And that will burn its way in.
All right.
And then there's the best way of shoeing, they say. You shoe them cones, as we call it.
Right.
You rasp it. You rasp and you level the hoof.
But like
you mightn't have it as level as you should have it, but still you could nail it on.
Right.
And it wasn't really level on it'd be maybe loosened after a month, maybe.
And rasping is like
you have to finish it off,
shaving it, or
shaving it up. You have to turn down the nails, you see.
Mm-hmm.
When you have a shoe on, you have to finish it off. We call it. There might be other words for saying it, but we turn down the nails, like.
Right.
And you give them a little rasp to clean them off, and you rough for the animal, like. Right. Hit the leg again, one another. That sort of thing, like, you know.
Do you ever do competitions or anything like?
Oh no, I don't know.
How long would you say it would take you to do from start to finish a shoe, one shoe?
To put it on, you mean?
Yeah, like to heat it up in the fire, cool it off.
To be quarter of an hour, roughly, I suppose, maybe, like, right. You know.
And then you pay.
The hunt started in 45 with a trencher-fed pack, just kept out in Buchels of Brown's barn that time. And Pat Byrne took him over then. I started coming up and hunting with Pat. I said, God, that's a long time ago. It must be in the late 50s or early 60s. So Pat died last year, suddenly, and left us with nothing. So we got together with a few local lads and got it going. And it's amazing the way it took off. And the goodwill of the farmers was marvellous. Every place we went, there couldn't be better or nicer to us. I went with three or four packs, but this one, I can't believe how it got on so well and how the farmers welcomed us. Nobody stopped us. And the hounds are going, and Paddy Clifford's doing a good job whipping them, and Rich is doing a good job hunting them, and everybody. Well, they misbehaving our time, but it's my job to keep them in line. But it's marvellous how it came back from nothing in 1 year. And we'd like to keep it on for the young lads coming up. Be pleased to see it going out of the area. And it's a gorgeous area to hunt in. A lot of country that you can hunt any time of the year because there's no corn or no... A lot of woods and a lot of forestries and woodstock and plenty of places to hunt. We have a nice little pack of hounds now. We have about 8 couples. But the job getting them together, but they're very, very good now. And I said this year, this coming year now, we're looking forward to a good season. But it's thanks to all the locals. It's all voluntary and everybody is thrown into it. It's all given their heart and given their time. But again, I'd say the farmers are the...
When did they first get their costumes?
Costumes. I got a coat for a fella down for Paddy down in Kerry, the old Harrier coat. I got another one for myself, and I got one for Richie. Richie's was one belonged to old Dr. McCarthy down in the Kilkenny Carriers.
Yes.
He died and his daughter gave us. We had to scratch around. It's easy to get a pink coat, but it's nearly impossible to get a green, a Harrier coat, you know.
So what's the difference?
Well, the Harrier is green, and we like that portrays Ireland as we see it. Now the pink, well, the other packs hunt in pink, and I think a pink coat is like a red rag to a bull to a farmer, because not saying we don't like England, but it's very English.
Now, all this film business seems to have started about 5 years ago when Wesley Burroughs wrote a script for a film from the book of Maeve Binchy called Light a Penny Candle. Now, this was from... at the instructions of a producer in America who had bought the rights to the film. But because of difficulties in America, the film was never made. And unfortunately, it was a great disappointment to everybody who had been working so hard on it, not least of all Wesley Burroughs. But as a result of some pre-production work done on that, other film makers became aware of Inistioge, and as a result of that, we had a visit from people who were making a film in Wicklow called Widow's Peak. Following on from the success of Widow's Peak, we had a visit about 6 months afterwards from another company. They were basically an American company who had got the rights of another book from Maeve Binchy. called Circle of Friends. This was scripted by a Welsh fellow called Andrew Davies, who was a major writer in the film business. Now, they chose Inistioge after looking at a number of locations around the country, one of them being Lismore in County Waterford, which was the hometown of Pat O'Connor, who was the director for the film. Now, Inistioge, they regarded it as ideal because there was space, there was streetscape and everything. And they felt that from the previous film, with its peak, that people were getting accustomed to filmmaking and that to the obvious affection they have for it and its people.
Eddie, I remember when I was very young and I'd be sweeping outside the cement and I'd look down and there you'd be down on the square, yourself and a few more, Jim Ryan and Pat Hogan and a few of you. Was that the start of your career in hurling or the start of you getting interested in hurling?
Well, it was a little bit before that, Kathleen. I remember one of my early or longest memories is being in the back of our own house, which, as you know, was beside Ryan's. And there was this big door. I didn't even know the Ryan's at this stage, but there was this big door between us, a big for letting cars or whatever, and I could hear this hurling going on inside. And eventually we started got to know one another as we grew up. I suppose we're only about two or three or whatever. And the Ryans, then we started hurling at the back, and then we moved out as we got bigger out to the square, and of course matches started from then, and Pat Hogan and David Dwyer and Watty Cullerton and all those started joining in, and we'd have matches then on the square, and it was every day as far as I think anyway.
The little knots of the congregation picking up their roaming companions hardly mentioned the sermon. There were more urgent things to fill their minds, the crops, and the fair, and their neighbours. For Patrick Kavanagh's Terry Flynn, poet, farmer, and lover from afar of beautiful young virgins, the responsibility of family, farm, and his own unyielding lust is a heavy one. The only solution is to rise above it all, to escape over the nearest horizon, or to Keith's.
Well, I suppose Inistioge has changed a lot since my young days in the early 60s. Immigration had wiped out all the young and vibrant people from the place. The forestry and the county council were the main employers, and farming was playing a major role in the economy of the village. Over half the houses were unoccupied and semi-derelict, and there were only about five young people between the ages of 18 and 30 living in the place, two girls and three boys, and with no entertainment at all except the odd dance in McDonald's Hall. Well, in the early 60s, three committees were formed, which were to have a major influence on the development of Inistioge. The Tidy Town Committee, the Gymkhana and Flakeol Committees were all very successful, with the Gymkhana and the Flakeol Committee bringing thousands of people and lots of money into the village. Various other festivals and regattas have been held with such success that Inistioge is now regarded as the most popular venue in the country for any outdoor event. And of course the appearance of the village and the presentation of amenity areas by the Tidy Town Committee and the FOSS workers would also have a lot to do with this. In June 79 to represent the area on the County Council, and in 82 I was selected to travel to Oslo in Norway to a conference, and I was so struck by the similarities of the wooded countryside and the love of the people have for their environment that I was determined on my return to preserve and develop Inistioge along similar lines. Although the council were carrying out good work in, at the boat slip and the green, I knew they wouldn't be in a position to do the type of work I had in mind because of the recently announced cutbacks in public spending. So I contacted ANCO, who helped me to start up a scheme to carry out restoration work in the area, employing young people. Well, although for the first few years there were only about 5 workers for periods, but because the work was so successful and valuable, the workforce has now increased to about 20. And I suppose it was because of this work that features such as Mount Sanford Castle, St. Columbkill's Well, the village stream, the boat slip, the square, and the village green have become such major features of the village that hundreds of people come every Sunday and every day during the summers, especially to see them. Now, these four schemes are going to continue, and they will highlight and preserve other features of the village yet to be unearthed, and will reveal the true and hidden beauty of Inistioge.
4 schemes, London phone calls, dug ditches, cleared forest, paved roads, stone walls, tidy lanes. Grand, but where's the crack? Where's the fun? Where's the dancing girls topless on a table pouring Guinness down your throat, asking you to tuck fivers into their G-strings? Where's the beat? Where's the rhythm? Where's the music? Where's the dance? In the county Kilkenny, on the banks of the Nore by lovely Clun Quay, where fishermen's cots, so snugly at anchor, as fair to behold as beauty could be. To walk by its river as twilight approaches, the sun is declining and shadows are long. How peaceful and happy by the banks of those waters, as the woodland re-echo the blackbird's sweet song. Inistioge in the valley it's famed for its beauty, with its canopied roads and its famous old square. No place in this wide world can match its rare beauty. No place in this wide world can ever compare.
She must all this.